أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا ونبينا وطبيب نفوسنا وحبيب قلوبنا أبي القاسم محمد صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم لا سيما بقية الله روحي وأرواح العالمين لتراب مقدمه الفداء أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم ادعوني أستجب لكم إن الذين يستكبرون عن عبادتي سيدخلون جهنم داخرين صلوات Respected scholars and elderly brothers and sisters and all brothers and sisters, Assalamu alaikum jami'an wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from His bounty so far has accepted inshallah our fasting during the days of the holy month of Ramadan and has blessed us and continue His blessing and shower His blessings upon us during the holy nights of the month of Ramadan so that inshallah we can gain provision for a day to come to all of us, a day that no wealth, no children, no family, no fame, no position, no attire will avail us other than the purity of the heart and the rewards that the Almighty God inshallah would have blessed us to come to our rescue. Tomorrow night, as inshallah you are aware, will be the very first night of the possible nights of Qadr and also the first night of the that we are commemorating, will be commemorating for Imam Ali alayhi salam as the night of the Shab-e-Zarbat and the striking of Amirul Mu'mineen alayhi salam. And inshallah I will speak about this, that how that these two occasions are coinciding, the martyrdom and the occasion of Amirul Mu'mineen alayhi salam and the night of Qadr. On the one hand, it is recommended to revive those nights with supplications and dua and invocation, and at the same time inshallah revive those nights with remembrance and talking about the virtues of Ahlul Bayt, in particular Imam Ali alayhi salam. In continuation of our discussion tonight and also to bridge for the coming nights, tonight inshallah I will have a presentation briefly to you, both about the significance of what we spoke about supplication, so that we benefit from the nights of the month of Ramadan more, and at the same time relating it to one of the virtues of Ahlul Bayt alayhi salam, Imam Amirul Mu'mineen alayhi salam, to share with you the living miracles of Ahlul Bayt. So inshallah the topic tonight will be about the living miracles of Ahlul Bayt alayhi salam. If somebody wanted to prove to those who have not started, inshallah they will start soon, have not yet started following the path of Ahlul Bayt, practicing the path of Ahlul Bayt alayhi salam, and are contemplating which path they should take in their life, I hope that the topic tonight will contribute to their positive decision, so that they are left inshallah with no doubt that definitely there is no any better alternative existing than the path of Ahlul Bayt alayhi salam, and inshallah I'll prove it to you. The ayah that I just recited and started my talk with, in which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala promises all of us that I'm there waiting for you. As I mentioned it last night, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that I'm so near to you, willing to grant, willing to communicate with me. call me and I will grant you. Some they say that when how many times I've been asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for things and was not given to me. The answer to that is, number one, there are conditions to my call. Sincerity and how really I am talking to God, whether my mind is with my tongue or I'm just quickly reading dua iftitah, for example, to get it done and finish it. Like a routine that I was told that in the month of Ramadan, every night I have to read dua iftitah. Is it that I relate to it? We have had some of our scholars that I remember, he is reading dua kumail, for example, halfway through he used to close the book of dua and says that that's enough for tonight. Shaykhana, don't you want to repeat to finish dua kumail? No, because up to this stage I had my heart with me. After I feel I'm losing my concentration, I have done it. It is not like namaz wajib that I have to complete it, finish it. This is a mustahab, it's a communication, intimacy with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You do as you can, as your heart is with you. It's not just a routine that we have to finish it, otherwise I have not done my job. Also, how many things that we ask, Quran says that how often that we are asking for things that is not to our benefit. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves us and cares about us more than us about ourselves. Due to my limited knowledge, I'm asking things that I later on regret it. A girl used to come to my office complaining that, Shaykh, I want to marry with that girl, with that guy. There's a boy that I know him from a Buddhist background. He's become a Muslim. He said his testimony, he's Muslim now, and my parents don't accept. They don't condemn this relation, they don't bless it. Can you speak with them? And I spoke with the family of the girl, and they had some valid points, and she was adamant. Eventually, the mother didn't budge, but the father surrounded. She said, well, what can I do, Sheikh? He brought his daughter, and the guy came, that Buddhist boy as well, and I solemnized the marriage. Although the father says that, are you sure you know him? Are you sure that you want to live with him and everything? And they were so much in love, romantic love, that doesn't last long, unfortunately. Believe me, few months later, the same girl, she was eating my brain off, that is your fault, Sheikh. You should not have married us. Allahu Akbar. For how many months you drove everybody crazy because you wanted to marry her? That's what Quran says, that how often man is calling for shar, for evil, unknowingly. And God says that because of my extra care to you, I know that if I give it to you, you come back and as you complain to Sheikh Mansour, you're going to complain to me as well. You say that, why God, you granted it to me? I know your interest better than you, number one. Number two, it's not that we are commanding to God that I want it right now. I want to get married and I have to get married right today, Ya Allah. God says, okay, that was a request. You put your supplication, your application, your submission, and in due course you will be given. I know when it is good for you, when the timing is good for you, I will give it to you. And in fact, if I don't give it to you because you have asked for something that was good for you, if due to my infinite wisdom I do not give it to you in dunya, rest assured you will get better than that in the hereafter. So much so that the Prophet says in my mi'raj, what I saw, some people they say that, Ya Rab, I wish none of my wishes had come through in this dunya. I wish all of them were reserved for me for my akhirah, had I knew that that much Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will compensate me. The very first lesson, let me share with you the very first lesson that I learned in the Islamic seminary. The first day, the first lesson from the first teacher. And still I remember, and my teacher has passed away. Inshallah, bless his soul with salawat ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. What a lesson. What a lesson, really. Inshallah, you will never forget it, as I have not. It's a quotation from the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wa alihi wasallam. The Prophet is quoted from said Awwalul ilm ma'rifatul jabbar. The first lesson for children, adults, anyone wants to get to the school of learning about God, the very first lesson of knowing God is to know this divine attribute that Allah is Al-Jabbar. Then my teacher explained that don't get the hadith wrong, don't misunderstand the Prophet. Jabbar doesn't mean arrogant. Astaghfirullah. God is not arrogant. Jabbar grammatically is sighe mubalighe. Sighe mubalighe, we use it when we want to mention a character that person is so rich with it, with exaggeration, sort of exaggeration. Like allam or allame, and someone who has so much knowledge from ilm. He said Jabbar means God compensates infinitely. Jabr, injibar, when the bone is broken, now that it's healing, they say yanjabiru kasur azmo, his bone is healing. Alright? So he said Jabbar is the one who compensates much. Anything, any hardship happens in your life, no matter how little or much, sickness, poverty, even as little as you want to get to your car, put your hand to your pocket to get the key. Ah, where is the key? Ah, it's here. That's the hadith for this, huh? That trivial discomfort, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will compensate you. So if you want to worship God, you have to know God. If you want to know God, the very first lesson of living an Islamic life, rest assured, sister, rest assured, brother, that God will compensate you much until you are pleased. وَلَسَوْفَ يُعْطِيكَ رَبُّكَ فَتَرْضَى. The Almighty God will grant you so much until you say, God, I'm so pleased. So much so that the Rawayat says that those who had especially long kind of illnesses in this dunya, long-term diseases, in the hereafter, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will compensate them so much that says, I wish I was never recovered in dunya. I wish I was never recovered in dunya. And that's why Imam Zainul Abidin alayhi salam in dua, Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. In Sahifah Sajjadiyah, he says, Ya Allah, I'm contemplating in which situation I should be more grateful. In the situation that I'm healthy and I can stand on my feet and worship you, or in a situation that I'm sick and bedridden. Well, when you are healthy, understandable, be grateful to God for the blessing of health. How come Imam Zainul Abidin says that even when you are sick, you have to be so grateful? Imam explains, he said, because when I'm sick and I'm bedridden, without doing anything, the counter is working. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is asking the angels, keep writing for him. His breathing, the breathing of a marid, a patient, is glorification. The sighing, my head. The sighing of a patient is glorification. Imam Zainul Abidin alayhi salam says, therefore when I'm sick, more rewards of worshipping is written for me, even though apparently physically I'm not doing anything. Read between the lines. So the very first lesson of knowing God is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala compensates. Ud'uni astajib lakum. Rest assured that I grant you. Then Quran says that إِنَّ الَّذِينَ يَسْتَكْبِرُونَ عَنْ عِبَادَتِي. Those who are too arrogant to worship me, I will humiliate them by admitting them into hell with humiliation. Some people, they are really too arrogant to ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Quran says that I mentioned that last night, deliberately sometimes put you through some hardship so that you acknowledge how poor you are. I like you to come and talk to me, communicate with me. If you don't come willingly, unwillingly, I bring you. Subhanallah, the arrogant people, kafir is the one who is denying God arrogantly and deliberately, not ignorantly. God says, look at this kafirin, they are so arrogant, even when they are sick, even when there is a family turmoil, even when there is a poverty striking them, instead of approaching God in that moment, they start accusing God. How cruel God is, look what kind of God is this. God says, such people I will humiliate them more. Quran says that if it was not because of your supplications, and if it was not because of supplication of some of you, inshallah I will touch on this, so that the last part of dua al-iftitah, you appreciated more, you would have been perished, you would have been finished. Allahu Akbar. If it was not because of your supplication and your dua. So one person in the community, maybe last night or tonight, is praying because of sincerity of that person, the generous God is forgiving the whole community. قُلْ مَا يَعْبَوْ بِكُمْ لَوْلَا دُعَاءُكُمْ. Question. There are some ahadith under this ayah that the Imams of Ahlul Bayt, they say, when they were asked the Abna Rasulullah, is it more virtuous to read the dua or read the Quran? I go to the mosque, and should I read Quran like the night of Qadr, Quran or dua? In some riwayat, the Imams, they say that supplication is more virtuous. In some riwayat, they say that reading Quran is more virtuous and afdal. What am I supposed to do? Reconciliation is the following. These ahadith, they seem paradoxical, apparently contradicting each other. Reconciliation is the following. It depends on the individual. If you are kind of a person that is slack with supplication, your medication is supplication. If you are kind of a person who is not acquainted with the Quran, your prescription is Quran. So you have to see who the Imam was talking to. Imams were like doctors, that a patient comes, he gives him a prescription. This person becomes a rawi, a narrator. He goes and shares the prescription with everybody. So everybody thinks that this is his prescription. And that's where the confusion comes. In general, the situation is the following. Quran and recitation of the Quran and reflection on the Quran, of course, is very, very virtuous because it's the word of God. So in terms of al-uluhiyya, divinity, Quran is more virtuous because it's the word of God. In terms of al-ubudiyya, humility before God, supplication is more virtuous because when I'm reading the dua, I'm expressing my humiliation before God. And this is what God wants from me. Okay, this is about this. Sallu ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. Now, in speaking with God, what should I ask Him? How should I communicate with God? Is there any etiquettes of talking to God? How to start? How to go about it? How to conclude? Subhanallah, this is where we come across the blessing of having infallible and ma'asumeen Imams of Ahlul Bayt alayhim salam. I have examined these on myself, and the exam is very easy. If now we say that, brothers, let everybody say one dua, how much can we say? Collect the books of dua, put them aside. On the night of Qadr, you sit and talk to God. What do you have to say? Maximum couple of personal issues, and then it's over. Really, we are so, excuse me with all respect, I'm talking about myself. So dumb, I don't know what to ask, how to talk to God, isn't it? Khaja Nasiruddin Tusi, one of the most eminent scholars of the 7th century, in his book, that his book was a textbook for several centuries until when I was studying, and still more or less his book is a textbook in Islamic seminaries. When he talks about miracles, he said we have two types of miracles. One, miracles of practice, that a prophet or a wali of awliyaullah performs something that others unable to do, impossible for them to do. Examples, when Jesus Christ is bringing dead who was buried months ago back to life, it's a miracle. When Prophet Isa, by the leave and permission of God, sticks his hits his stick to the Nile and split it in two. This is miracle, and all the miracles of the prophets, including the Prophet of Islam, these are miracles by action. All right. The second kind of miracles, he said, the miracles of speech. Like, for example, the best example of it is the Holy Quran. Why is it that the Quran is a living miracle? Khaja Nasiruddin Tusi, he says, because miracles of action, they only belong to the time of the action and to the witnesses of the scene. You and I, just because we believe in Quran, we believe in the miracle of Jesus being born without a father. Still today, there are some liberal Christians, even they don't believe in that. Astaghfirullah, they are accusing Sayyidah Maryam, as the Jews accused her. There are so many people, they say, no, this is a fairy tale. Who says that he hid the sea, the Nile, and split it to two? I wasn't there, how should I know? Shaqqul Qamar, they deny it. Unless you have faith, otherwise there's no way to prove it to the present generation, for example. We were not there. But Khaja Nasir says that for the laymen, for the general public who were there, they are more impressed with the miracles of action. Once they see that pebbles in the hand of the Prophet glorify God, wow, this man must be a godly man. Miracle, they admit it. He said the community of the elite, the educated people, they appreciate the miracles of speech more because they are elite, because they are educated. When they come across, like for example, a speech, a literature that is so profound, they admire the writer more than just a miracle of action. Okay, Imam Ali alayhi salam says, "Al mar'u makhbu'un tahta lisane." If you want to check the credentials of people, let them speak, read their literature, and it is then you can tell about his credentials. Otherwise, I could have a driving license without any driving experience, isn't it? There are people that they have no skills of driving, but they have driving license. Does it mean anything? Could have numbers of degrees. But when you talk to him, say, no, it really doesn't have anything. So degree necessarily, they don't mean anything. It's the production, as it's in our ahadith. You can tell, you can know the fruit by its, a tree by its fruit. You know the tree by its fruit. Now we want to come to the discussion that the Imams of Ahlul Bayt alayhimus salam, also they had two types of miracles that to differentiate it with the mu'ajizat of the prophets, we refer to them in Arabic as Al-Karamat. Some of them actions, like Imam Zainul Abidin alayhimus salam visited someone and he was, see, they said that fulan and fulan is very ill and there is no cure for him. Imam says, we go and visit him. The moment that the Imam entered the house of the person, his fever dropped. The person was cured before the Imam even touching him. This is a miracle of an Imam Masum, Karamat. But again, this one was at the time of Imam Zainul Abidin. For those who saw the scene, I want tonight to share with you a living miracle or living miracles of Ahlul Bayt alayhi salam that no one can argue. Says that how would I know? Sheikh, how would I know that was the miracle of Imam Zainul Abidin alayhi salam? I tell you that I share with you something tonight that is still existing, is around, and is easily you can have access to it as we have it with salawat ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. And that is the words of Ma'asumin alayhi salam. We start from a lower level until we go up. The lower level that is still is high is when the Imams of Ahlul Bayt alayhimus salam answering questions. People, they come and answer. They answer according to the mentality, understanding of the questioner. But when they go up on a stage that they are addressing the general public, like Amirul Mu'mineen, Imam alayhi salam, when he's delivering his sermons, Sayyid Ravi, who himself was a linguist, he just selected some of the sermons, letters, and words of wisdom of Imam Ali alayhi salam, and Nahj al-Balagha was compiled. In Nahj al-Balagha, I just mentioned a few because I want to just pass through quickly. There is a sermon known as Khutbatul Muttaqin. A man with the name of Hammam comes and Imam goes up on a stage to give a lecture. For us, we have to kill ourselves, prepare ourselves. Imam is going up on a stage to give a lecture. Hammam says, "Ya Amir al-Mu'minin, could you please tonight speak about the characters of the pious people?" The Imam answers him less than a sentence, less than a line. "Be pious and be with the pious people, with the muhsanin, righteous people." Hammam says, "Ya Ali, I know that much. Please give me more explanation about the pious people." Imam says, "Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, Khutbatul Muttaqin. I've counted more than 100 characteristics of the pious people in such a rhetorical way, eloquent way, in spontaneously, with no preparation." And you know why? Because the Imam is talking about himself. When you read it, you see who other than Imam meets all these characteristics. And so influential in his presentation, is still Imam is talking. Over 100 characteristics is mentioned, and imagine Hammam is sitting in front of the Imam, his jaw dropped. And as the Imam talks, and he died. It's in Nahj al-Balagha, historians have recorded this. The guy died in front of Amir al-Mu'mineen. And Imam says that that's why initially I didn't give him a full answer. I knew his heart cannot take it. There is another sermon, sermon 221 of Nahj al-Balagha. You know, Nahj al-Balagha is not only the book of the Shia. Many Sunni scholars, they have written interpretation and commentary on Nahj al-Balagha. One of the very famous one is a Mu'tazili scholar whose name is Ibn Abil Hadid. He has a very comprehensive sharh interpretation of Nahj al-Balagha in 20 volumes in Arabic is published. This man, he says that when I came across some of the khutab, like for example, he mentions there is a sermon in Nahj al-Balagha that the Imam is giving interpretation of Surah At-Takathur. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, Al-Hakum At-Takathur. He says that this sermon, I have read it for the last 50 years of my life at least 1,000 times. 1,000 times I have read this sermon, that I know it off by heart. And still, every time I read Nahj al-Balagha and I read this sermon again, I have a goosebump, I shiver. I've taken some of my students more than once to the cemeteries, opened Nahj al-Balagha and read that sermon interpretation of Al-Hakum al-Takathur and explained it, read it to translation. Tears follow from, on the cheek of this young man, mashallah. So influential. Imam alayhi salam sits on the minbar to give a lecture. Someone says, "Ya Ali, today we have a request. We with brothers were debating something, that is it possible that you give us today a lecture in Arabic?" Between brackets, quick brackets. Arabic language consists of 28 or 29 alphabets. There isn't a 28 or 29 because there are different opinions. Let's say 28, famous opinion. Half of the Arabic letters have dots, nukte, half they don't. Okay? You all know that. Now, the man says that, "Ya Ali, give us a lecture, use half of the letters of Arabic. We don't want you to say Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim because Ba has nukte. Give a lecture, use half of the alphabet." Imagine how well versed are you in English. If somebody tells you, come all of the sudden on the stage, not that go come back to me next month in writing, spontaneously go up on a stage, give a lecture, use half of the English alphabet. Is it possible? Can we fathom even to do that? The sermon is available. Google search it, you easily find it, alhamdulillah, these days. Imam alayhi salam spontaneously delivers the lecture. Isn't it a miracle or is not a miracle? You find me on earth, you find me in the history of Islam, any scholar, any khalifa, any Muslim, who has ever been able to produce, this is what my Imam has produced. Tell me what your Imam has produced. Honestly, compared with what I want to share with you, is nothing. Sallu ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. When Imams of Ahlul Bayt were addressing humans, they had to just bring themselves down to earth. Down to earth. Simplification. So that humans understand them. They themselves, they said it, that we speak to the level of understanding of our audience. Now, when they turn towards the Qibla, now when Amir al-Mu'mineen wants to talk to God, Allahu Akbar, we will be all lost. We will be all lost. But their literature is there. I tell you and I challenge if anyone can prove me wrong. In the Islamic literature, in the Islamic heritage, Shia, Sunni, Ismaili, you name, go for any denomination. Impossible to find supplications that we have from the Imams of Ahlul Bayt alayhimus salam, so profound in meaning, so rhetoric in the rhythm of it. Impossible to find it anywhere else. Unique living miracles of the Imams of Ahlul Bayt alayhimus salam. Aren't these the best proofs? We don't need to go to theological debates and discussions. My friend, get dua kumail and tell them this is what my Imam has produced. Dua Abu Hamzat al-Somali, dua Mujir. Allahu Akbar. This dua al-iftitah that we just recited it, we just read it. Reflect and spend some time. It's an article of faith. It's said by Imam Zaman and Jalallah Ta'ala Faraju Sharif during the time of occultation. This is what the Shia believe, from beginning to the end. Look at the description of the Imam about Tawheed and Monotheism, the first half of Dua Iftitah. Amazing how profound it is. The second part of it is about Muwahid, because the entire Islamic teaching is about Tawheed and Muwahid, Monotheism and Monotheist. Amazingly. Dua Abu Hamzat al-Somali that Imam Zain al-Abidin used to stand up on his feet reciting dua. We find it difficult to read it from, you know, all of it seated. Subhanallah, look how profound it is. One of my friends, colleagues, some of you may know him. He used to follow the path of Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah. A sheikh, now became Shia. He said, you know, Sheikh Mansour, what impressed me and I finally decided to change my way of practicing Islam, the supplications of the Imams of Ahlul Bayt alayhi salam. Because as a Sunni scholar, I'm telling you, we don't have nothing even close to that in our literature. Nothing close to that. And he's got Arabic background. He said, as a person who reads and understands the supplications, I said, these are not ordinary humans. These are not ordinary humans. Impossible. Every year I'm blessed to go to Hajj. May God bless all of us, inshallah, to go more and more. I like Dua Abu Hamzat al-Somali a lot. With the brothers, a couple of years ago, we went to Hajj in Masjid al-Haram, the second floor. If you've been there under the big clock, that was where we would meet. Facing the Ka'bat al-Mu'azzamah, I was reading Dua Abu Hamzat al-Somali and the brothers around me. In one of the nights, we finished Dua Abu Hamza, and you know that it's quite long. I turn and some of the brothers say, Sheikh, there are two brothers in the back, they want to talk to you. I looked back, there were two brothers from Yemen, Zaydi. They came close and the brothers, they told me that you had just started, that they were passing by, they stood up a while and then they sat down. They explained themselves. They said, yes, we're passing by, we overheard you. First, we thought you are reading Quran. We listened carefully. No, this is not Quran. But look at the melody of it. How profound. Because they're Arabic speaking people. They said the magnet of this supplication caught us so strongly, like we were frozen. We were just listening, and then we decided to sit down. We sat and listened to the whole dua. He said, brother, where did you get this from? I said, this is from Imam Ali ibn al-Husayn ibn Ali, Abi Ali ibn Abi Talib, his grandfather Amir al-Mumni, grandmother Fatima al-Zahra, the daughter of the Prophet. This is from Imam Zainul Abidin alayhi salam. Tell me more about Imam Zainul Abidin. I'm not exaggerating. God is my witness. I mentioned something more about him. And he said, they, both of them, they said, can we, lucky? We said, every night we meet here after midnight. He said, tomorrow night we come as well. We like to listen to it again. So by all means. The following night they came, but the following night the brothers, they said, Sheikh, tonight we want you to read Dua Josh and Al-Kabir for us. What is Dua Josh and Al-Kabir? Dua Josh and Al-Kabir consists of 1,000 divine names and attributes. 1,000. Allahu Akbar. We started, we were reading Dua Josh and Al-Kabir. I naturally didn't notice. After the Dua, I saw those two brothers again. They said, Sheikh, this is different from last night. I said, yes, that's a different one. Amir al-Mu'mineen, we have 150 supplications from him. These are just a handful of them. The 150 supplications that dua come is one of them. They said, where are you getting this from? I said, here is the book, Mafatih al-Jinan. And still, this is not the primary source. It's much more into it. I swear to God, I spent about half an hour, 1 hour talking to them. Both of them, they said that we want to come to home and study, we want to become Shia. We want to follow the footsteps, we want to learn Islam from these imams. These guys are not ordinary people. The one who can say, talk to God spontaneously, talking about 1,000 divine names, no ordinary, no scholar can ever do that. They are not just scholars, not ulama. We know our scholars. We have seen the literature of our scholars. How blessed we are to have access to this treasury, the hidden treasury, the living miracles of the Imams of Ahlul Bayt alayhi salam. My time unfortunately is over, but I just answer quickly one misgiving and inshallah few words of musibah. The misgiving or the shubha, the doubt that some they have is that some of the supplications of the Imams, like in Dua Abu Hamza, like Dua Kumail, when we read, we see that, for example, Imam alayhi salam says, Allahumma ghafir li al-dunub allati tahbisu al-dua. Allahumma ghafir li al-dunub allati tunzilu al-niqam. I'm deliberately mentioning parts of Dua Kumail that you're more familiar with. And then Imam Sadiq alayhi salam says, the sins that, for example, brings the calamity down is injustice for tyrants, adultery, God forbid, big horrible sins. Astaghfirullah, is it possible that Imam alayhi salam is seeking God's forgiveness for this kind of sins? So what is the Imam is talking about? The same for Dua Abu Hamza. Oh Allah, I'm the one who did not respect you publicly, was not scared of you privately. Is it Imam Zainul Abidin alayhi salam? So what is the meaning of this? This has baffled some scholars even to find a satisfactory answer to it. In a nutshell, there are numbers of reasons I'll share with you, see which one you relate to. And the last one, I myself, it's the one that I have some very good reasons to incline towards. One answer, they say that the Imams are performing, as if like the Imam was performing. Imam is not talking about himself, he's teaching us. He's telling me that if you are kind of person who's been unfair to your family, this part of the dua is for you. If God forbid in the crowd anybody had ever committed adultery, this part of the dua is for him. You learn how to seek forgiveness and so forth. So the Imam is rather like a reciter in a majlis that someone's dear had passed away. You hire a reciter to come and read majlis. He even doesn't know the deceased, but he reads majlis in such a way that you see, and he's crying just to have sympathy with us. Okay? So it's just rather a performance. I'm not impressed by this answer, with all respect to those who say that. The second answer that some they have given, they say that the Imams of Ahlul Bayt alayhi salam are saying it for themselves. Ajib. For themselves, they say yes. Hasanatul Abrar, Sayyatul Muqarrabin. the sins that they have for themselves in their level still is sin. They are seeking Allah's repentance in their level and has a different meaning to their level. Again, I cannot accept this one. Especially given the examples, that harsh examples that are deliberately picked up from some of the dua. What do you mean? To which level Imam Ali alayhi salam astaghfirullah committed adultery? That he's seeking God's forgiveness? This is not a satisfactory answer. So the answer that comes to my mind, and I'd like to briefly share it with you, is that the Imams of Ahlul Bayt, when they were reading these supplications, they were not performing. They were not like teaching us, they were talking to God themselves. But because He is the Imam, the leader of the community, He puts Himself in my shoes as a sinful person. He carries my sin on His shoulder, Imam al-Zaman. In these nights, every single night of the month of Ramadan, Imam al-Zaman, who has read this Sual Iftitah for the first time and is reading it every Ramadan, every night of Ramadan, he is like taking my sin on his holy shoulder. And he's seeking Allah's forgiveness for me. Not that he's performing. The same for Amir al-Mu'mineen, the same for Imam Zainul Abidin, because they were the Imams. It's just like the father who goes to the court, a mother who goes to the court, such a compassionate mother says, "Judge, Your Majesty, punish me for my son. It was me who did that." Like he's taking it upon himself. She's taking it upon herself. This is the only understanding that I can have from this dua. So Imam Zaman, Imam Zain al-Abidin, these nights, they are taking the sins of all the sinful people in the community worldwide. Among them are some who, God forbid, have committed adultery. Among them who have been unfair. Among them, you name it. They take it all upon themselves and ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to forgive us. This is an angelic attitude. We have an ayah in the Quran that angels, in a certain degree, they also do that and seek Allah's forgiveness for the believers, even though they are sinful believers. How unfair I would be to myself that my Imam is seeking Allah's forgiveness for me and I don't seek Allah's forgiveness for myself. Inshallah, we remember that in the coming nights, these nights, until the end of the month of Ramadan, inshallah, spend some time, some private time of our nights in seeking Allah's forgiveness, inshallah. Sallu ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. And every time you want to seek Allah's forgiveness, you make sure that you go through the means that He has introduced to us. Ya ayyuhalladhina amanu ittaqullaha wabtaghu ilayhi alwasila. Ittaqullaha wabtaghu ilayhi alwasila. Seek the means that Allah has introduced. The Imams of Ahlul Bayt, they have said, we are the means. A means that I want to introduce tonight to you. And inshallah, ask Allah, beseech the Almighty God, in respect of this young teenage boy who has just reached the age of becoming a teenager. According to some narrations, لم يبلغ الحلم. He had not reached the age of puberty even yet. His name is Al-Qasim, the orphan of Imam Hassan Mujtaba alayhi salam. When his father was martyred, Al-Qasim ibn al-Hassan was only 3 years old or so. On the day of Ashura and the night before that, you know the story that Imam Hussein alayhi salam is asking, how would you perceive death for the sake of God? And he said, sweeter than honey. On the day of Ashura, this young boy, he comes to his uncle, who was like a father for him. I don't know, among you, do you have anyone who has nephews? And especially, inshallah, doesn't exist. If you have a nephew that your brother has passed away, God forbid, and your nephew is brought up by you, we care sometimes for our nephews more than our own children, especially if he is an orphan. The orphan of Imam Hassan Mujtaba alayhi salam comes to his uncle Imam Hussein. Ya Amma, uncle, You promised me last night that I will be among the martyrs. Ya Amma, I saw Ali Akbar gone. The Bani Hashim, Jabanan Bani Hashim were martyred one after the other. Uncle, I cannot stand it anymore. Please give me permission to go and fight. Wallah, I can also fight. Imam Hussein alayhi salam hugged the nephew, the trust of the brother. They have written that the nephew and the uncle hugged each other hard and they cried until they felt faint. What shall Imam Hussein alayhi salam do? He loves Qasim so much and at the same time is for the sake of God. He let him go for the sake of God. Until after a bit of fighting, Qasim comes back and says, Uncle, I'm thirsty. We are fasting through the month of Ramadan to remember also the thirst of Ahlul Bayt. Uncle, I'm thirsty. If there is a drop of water, I can fight them back to death. Imam Hussein alayhi salam says, my dear nephew, my dear Qasim, your uncle is thirstier than you. But I have a good news for you, go back fighting. Soon your thirst will be quenched from the hand of your father. Your father Imam Hassan is waiting for you at the gate of paradise. It was after that Imam heard the painful cry of Qasim, Ya Ahmad, rikni. Ala la'natullah ala al-qawm al-zalimin wa say'alamu al-lazina zalamu أيام قلب ينغلبون أمن يجيب المضطر إذا دعاه ويكشف السوء 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 بجاه محمد وآل محمد وبحرمة الفاتحة مع الصلوات.